Recording in progress.
Good morning. Grace to you and peace from the God who creates and redeems and sustains us. Welcome to the First Presbyterian Church of Lansdowne. We're glad that you are worshiping here with us this morning. Happy Advent 4. We're not quite on Christmas Eve just yet. Christmas Eve, technically, according to the church this year, starts at noon. I don't make the rules. We have a few announcements this morning before we get started with worship. First, our liturgist today is Rida. Thank you for doing that. And it looks like we've got Chris on AV, and the Rexes are doing Children's Church this morning, so thank you all for that. If you're worshiping with us online, we ask that you put your prayer requests into the chat now so that we can recognize those when we get to the prayers of the people. And this is just a reminder that the 7 p.m. service tonight will not be Zoomed. It won't be recorded. It'll just be everybody here in the sanctuary. The Advent Bible study is continuing. If folks want to stay after worship today for Bible study, we'll do that at 11:30 in the Knoll Chapel. I understand you may have other plans for today. So that's totally fine. I don't have many other plans for today, so If people want to do Bible study, then we can do that. If not, totally understandable. We will not have the Thursday evening session this coming week. I will be out of town. So just so you know, that won't be happening Thursday evening this coming week. The Interfaith Food Cupboard is requesting beef stew still for the month of December. So thank you for donating that if you can. The donation bin is in the vestibule of Westminster. Again, worship tonight is at 7 p.m. This will be our no-fuss, unrehearsed Christmas pageant where anybody can come and be a part of the different part of the service. You can dress up as a sheep or a magi, or we can have three Marys, or you know, however we want to do that. There are very few rules in this pageant. So that'll be at 7 p.m. tonight, and then we'll end with the service of light with the candle lighting and singing Silent Night, Joy to the World. There will not be an 11 p.m. service this year. So it'll just be this morning, which you're already here for, and then 7 p.m. tonight. Also, I've been asked to remind you two things about the poinsettias. The dedications and the honorariums for that are printed in the bulletin. If you're online, those should have been emailed out to you this week, so everybody has that. And if you're not, if you ordered a poinsettia or numerous poinsettias, if you're not planning on being here at the 7 p.m. service tonight, please go ahead and take your poinsettias after worship this morning. Take those home with you so that those can go to their new homes. What's that? And Patty has the checkoff list to know who's already taken their poinsettias. All right, fantastic. If you are visiting with us this morning, we want to welcome you to worship. We are glad that you are here. We will have coffee hour in Westminster Hall after worship today, which is in the building right behind us in the sanctuary. If you see an unfamiliar face, please be sure to introduce yourself. And I think those are all of the announcements. I'm going to invite Direxa and Harry up to lead us in our Advent candle lighting.
The final announcement of God's peace campaign played out against the unambiguous sign of an exploitative economy, the census.
Our guide for this season, Kelly Nicandeha, writes in her book, "Caesar's census was not about demographic numbers. It was an inventory of wealth that allowed the empire to further spread the burden of taxation. A census was always bad news for the poor, never lightening their load. From time to time, though, a census was known to ignite rebellion."
In this season, we remember and claim that God's advent was first announced to those on the outside of power and prestige, to the smelly shepherds out in the fields.
We claim that Advent is just the beginning of our journeys toward more just economies and more peaceful politics.
We light the fourth Advent candle this morning as a sign of the coming of Christ. Let us remind ourselves that God's Advent, both then and now, comes to people in conflicted lands and broken economies. Will you pray with me? God of the poor, the outcast, and the heavy laden, we wait and hope for your reign because it is better than what we see around us. Into this yearning, remind us that your advent was not just once and for all, but is still breaking into our world today. May we join in your renewed campaign for peace and equity and walk in the light of Christ. Amen.
Friends, this Advent, we have resolved ourselves again to the worshiping of the Prince of Peace and following along his path. Yet we know that we fall short of Christ's example, so we come week after week to acknowledge our shortcomings and devoting ourselves anew to the work of peace. So let us confess together what we have done and what we have left undone to a merciful and a gracious God. Please join me in prayer. God, in the stillness and darkness of the night, we know fear. We are afraid of something jumping out from somewhere we cannot see. Sounds with unknown origins send shivers down our spines. How much more so did the shepherds know these feelings? Even though we know the light comes, and the greetings of a host of angels should gird up our hearts, sometimes they do not. In the sureness of your advent, lift us out of the darkness to an illumined world that knows how to love like you. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The assurance of pardon is this. God says to the shepherds, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. May it be so. Friends, God's advent is upon us. Thanks be to God for a new kind of peace. Amen. Thank you.
Please join me in our illumination prayer. On the outskirts of society, you announce good news, O God. Move our focus there, away from the center and towards the margins. In your Advent story, cast our gaze farther afield to see where you are moving. Amen.
I'm going to invite our children to come forward. Come on down for the youth chat. Come on up. Good morning. Good morning. I like your sweater. Good morning. Good morning. How's everybody doing today? I'm going to scoot over. All right. So in the spirit of Christmas, somebody gave me a gift this morning. They gave me a book on the Nativity, so I thought we would read that this morning. It sort of tells the Christmas story, and it's got some really good illustrations in it, so we're going to take a look. You guys ready? Okay. Has anybody read this one before? No? Okay. I bet it's probably pretty familiar in some ways. All right. In the days of King Herod, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, and the virgin's name was Mary. Does that look like any angel you've ever seen before? Looks different, doesn't he? What looks different about him? What about him? They're real wings. Sort of looks like a bat, doesn't he? Then they're really, really big. And he's got some boots on, too. That's kind of cool. All right, let's see. And the angel said unto her, Hail, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled. Oh no, he got a little hung up in the trees here, didn't he? Oh, and here's the woman. She's out here hanging clothes, hanging laundry, doing what people do, right? Normal everyday stuff. Oh no, look at his wings. The angel said, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Thou shalt bring forth a son and call his name Jesus." There's a lot of very formal language in there, isn't there? They're sitting there having some tea, having a nice conversation. Oh, goodness. She's becoming very pregnant, isn't she? And it came to pass that Caesar Augustus decreed that all the world should be taxed, and everyone to his own city. So it looks like they're saddling up. Man, she is very pregnant, isn't she? Is that going to be a fun journey on the back of a donkey? Yeah, probably not, right? Yeah. So Joseph went from Nazareth to the city of Bethlehem with Mary, his wife, being great with child. That's a very nice way of putting it, isn't it? There's a lot of people traveling. There's Mary. Oh, she's having a great time, isn't she? Mm-hmm. Oh, wow, look at this house. So many people. Am I pouring something out? You think everybody's going to fit? No? Thousands or hundreds? Yeah, that definitely is a lot of people. All right, let's see what happens. And so it was that while they were there, the day came that she should be delivered. So she should be having this baby. She brought forth her firstborn son. We're going to play him peekaboo over here. Peekaboo. There he is. Yeah. And she wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. We've heard that before. Look at, she looks pretty tired, doesn't she? And then we got Joseph over here. Does Joseph look like he knows what he's doing? Absolutely not. No. Joseph has no clue what he's doing. They were in the same country, shepherds in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, when lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were so afraid. They were so afraid. Oh, goodness. That same angel, with his tattered wings, is about to head out to some shepherds. Oh, goodness. They're riding the sheep. Oh, no. And the angel said, "Fear not, for I am bringing great tidings of great joy. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ our Lord. And this shall be a sign, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God. Does it look like they're praising God in that picture? They're having a great time, aren't they? Riding all those sheep, that could be a way of praising God. When the angels were gone, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go into Bethlehem to see this thing which has come to pass." Oh, so there goes the shepherds, and they're sending the sheep back, telling them where to go. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Look at him. He's so precious, isn't he? Yeah, and they're just checking him out. And behold, there came wise men to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born the King of the Jews? For we have seen his star, and have come to worship him." And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it stood still over where the young child was. So this angel's having some trouble. Still hanging up here in the tree. People with camels. There's a star, though. We got a star. More clothes out on the laundry here. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. So the angel's still over here hanging out. They got baby Jesus. They're giving him gifts. Hanging out on the floor. Very cute. The wise men departed into their own country, and the shepherds also returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen. And the child was called Jesus, which was so named by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. So now, look at this. We got the angel holding baby Jesus for a minute while Mary gets back up onto the donkey, because now they have to go home, right? That's going to be a fun journey. And that's the end. All right. That's kind of cool, right? A little different nativity story than the one maybe we've heard. A little bit more real, a little bit less fluffy and pretty and a little bit more maybe somewhat realistic, yeah? Is that the story that you've got pictured in your mind? Is that what you think an angel looks like? No, it's different, right? And that's okay, yeah. And it looks like a lumberjack with the boots and stuff? Absolutely, yeah, absolutely, yeah. So my challenge at this point is to just sort of expand your imagination as to what you think the nativity story might sound like, and that goes for the rest of us as well. Will you guys say a prayer with me? All right, repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for coming into the world to show us how to love. Amen. All right. Thanks for coming up this morning, everybody. If you guys want to go, the Children's Church is actually going to be over here in the Knoll Chapel this morning, okay? All right. Can you hear me now? Okay. Thanks. This is great. I love this book already. Betsy gave me that this morning. I was like, this is the perfect children's sermon. For more ways than I knew, we're actually going to come back to this here in just a minute. So hold that thought. Grab my water. Might need that. Okay, so good morning again. Hi. Because the fourth Sunday of Advent and Christmas Eve have coincided this year with each other, that's making this Advent season a little wonky, so we're still technically for another hour and 30 minutes, we are still in the fourth Sunday of Advent. But what I want to do is sort of blur those lines even a little bit more this morning, because we're only having the one service this evening. This is going to serve as both your Christmas Eve and fourth Sunday of Advent sermon, so you're welcome. There won't be a sermon tonight at the 7 p.m. service, just to make that abundantly clear. Advent 4, Christmas Eve, we're going to try to attempt to have Jesus's birthday cake and eat it too. So as we've been leading up to this text over the last several weeks, this Luke 2 text, what the gospel writer of Luke has done is try to set Jesus within his socioeconomic and political context of first century Palestine. So what happens is we hear about the timing of Jesus' birth as it relates to other events, other things that are happening around the time of Jesus' birth. So when he sets the stage here, we get sort of this greater context that we're going to talk a little bit about this morning. So this is Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. This is your very traditional Christmas story. In those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. And he went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver the child. She gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. Now in that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words in her heart and pondered them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. And after 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, and the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So what we've been doing this Advent season is using the land of Palestine, both ancient and modern, to help us understand the story of Advent and Christmas. One of the reasons that we do that is because it tends to lead us, I think, to new and profound and extremely relevant takeaways, not just how to understand the story, but also how it relates to the world today. One of the consequences of that is that we tend to get a clearer understanding of what the gospel writers and their first listeners, in Luke's case, the ones that he was actually writing to, what they had in mind or unconsciously knew when they were listening to this story for the first time. For example, we've been talking over the last several weeks about how occupation was subconsciously imbued within their individual and collective psyches, and how that affected not just them, but the stories that came out of this. But one of the other interesting things that it tends to do is it tends to help us get a more accurate picture of what the context and the backdrop for Christ's birth looked like. And so we have things that we can do with that to sort of debunk some of the inaccurate myths about that birth. For example, the myth of the inhospitable innkeeper. Who here has the picture of that person in their mind? Everyone's heard this, the inhospitable innkeeper, there's no room for them in the inn. What if I told you that there was no inhospitable innkeeper because there is no innkeeper in the story at all? This is because in verse 7 of Luke 2, we have stumbled into one of the great mistranslations of the Bible. For those who have been going above and beyond their devotional readings this month, you may have read in the book that the Advent devotionals are based off of, The First Advent in Palestine, where she talks about this scene. She writes, she says, quote, "Most Advent scenes we construct misunderstand the scenario that greeted Joseph and Mary and many others upon their arrival. They were welcomed by their family. However, we were told that there was no room for them in the inn, a phrase better understood as there is no space for them in the usual guest room of the house. Room was made for everyone, even if it was a corner here or a stable there." So what is she talking about? Now, to be sure, the word that is translated as in Luke 2 can mean that. It's not out of the realm of possibilities. But this word is used only 3 times in all of the New Testament. And both of the other two times, it refers to the guest room in someone's house. Specifically, it refers to the guest room where Jesus and his disciples had their final meal during the Passover. There's another word that typically get used for public accommodations, for an inn. So what difference does this make? Well, remember that according to the narrative, Joseph and Mary are traveling to Bethlehem because that is where Joseph's family is from. So it is likely then that Joseph still had family in Bethlehem. And Mary and Joseph have been traveling with that family's house in mind as their final destination. But if everyone from that same family line is also coming back, that's potentially a lot of people, just like we see here in the book. I'm assuming that is the family house, and those are all the people in the family. So that house would have been absolutely packed. Now we should stop here and talk for just a second about what a typical house in Bethlehem would have looked like at this point. What I want you to imagine, or now you don't really have to imagine so much, if you can see this, is a two-room house, or a two-story house with a flat roof. So you can sort of see that here. This is actually fairly historically accurate. Again, thank you. On the first floor, you would have essentially had three things. You would have had storage, you would have had something akin to a kitchen, and you would have had the stable. This would have been where you put your chickens and your goats or your donkeys, any of your other livestock that you might have had that you lived with. You would have brought them in at night to keep them safe from predators or from wandering off or from getting stolen, things like that. You would have brought them, and they would have actually lived on the first dirt floor of the house. Then above that, on the second floor, you would have had perhaps a couple of rooms where most of your day-to-day activity, your indoor activity would have happened. This would have been where people slept. This would have been where, if you had guests, you would have entertained them. This would have been where you would have eaten meals. And then above that, you would have had this flat roof on the third floor. Third floor is a bit generous, but a flat roof where people would have also spent a fair amount of time. There would have been ladders going from each of these things with holes for people to crawl up. ADA was not a thing at this point. People would have even slept there in the summertime on the roofs of the house because it would have been the coolest place. You would have hopefully gotten a little bit of breeze. So all of this would have been under the same roof. So what is more likely to be the case is that when Mary and Joseph found their way to the family house in Bethlehem, they would have opened up the door and the house would have been packed. Even though there was no room for them on the second floor of the house, the typical guest room of the house, the family would have made room for them downstairs on the dirt first floor. But even at that point, the kitchen and the storage already had other people there. So what room was left? The stable where the manger was. Mary and Joseph were not kicked out to the curb. They were welcomed in by their family. And so what that means is that Jesus was not born out in some random stable, but was born surrounded by his family in his ancestral house in Bethlehem. For centuries, this story, this nativity story, has had the unfortunate consequence of making Bethlehem seem like an unwelcome and an inhospitable place. But that is actually the opposite of what the story was intended to tell. What Luke was trying to show us was that the family made room even though there was hardly any left. If it was the last thing that they could do, Joseph's family was going to have that baby born, was going to have that baby born in the house that night. And then the story shifts. The story shifts to the fields outside of the city. Luke has already taken us to the home of an inconsequential family and now moves us even farther to the outskirts of society, out to the shepherds. Our guide again for the season, the author Kelly Nicandeha, writes in her book about the shepherds. She says that shepherds were essentially just an economic necessity, but often looked down on by those of higher status in society. Shepherding was usually the work of the children of the family to tend to their parents' flocks. So to be a lifelong shepherd was to do a child's chore your entire life. Oftentimes they were seen as trespassers, having the sheep graze where they weren't allowed. They often had to tussle or they had to compete for access to water, to water rights. Where have we heard that before? In other words, you couldn't get much lower than a shepherd. And yet this is where God's host of angels decides to show up. And they tell them to look for their Savior in a manger, an image that they would have understood. And so when they get to the city, they find Joseph's family house. Now, if you were in an overcrowded house and just went through, let's call it the excitement of delivering a baby in a stable surrounded by livestock, you might rightly so wish for the rest of your evening to be calm. If you were Mary, you were probably just hoping to get some sleep. But that is not how the story goes. The shepherds show up then. These lowly outcast of people show up to the house, and what happens? They too are welcomed in by the family. Nicandeha again says, she says, quote, they made room for the shepherds just as their extended family had made room for them. During times of duress, hospitality among the downtrodden was and is a method of mutual survival and welcome, itself added to hope to challenging times. And for me this season, I think that is the crux of the Advent and the Nativity story this year. That hospitality and the communities we live and create are the things that will save us. They are the things that will save us from the worst parts of empire. For Mary and Joseph, having to comply with the census, with the registration, was a huge burden. Being forced to uproot your entire life, especially as you are about to give birth, shows the power that the emperors and their dictates can have over a people group. They can be overly burdensome, they can be humiliating, they can be dehumanizing, and in the worst of cases, they can be deadly. But when Mary and Joseph showed up to that house, their family welcomed them in and made sure that they would be safe. And then they, then in turn, welcomed the shepherds who may have been an even more vulnerable people. This past Thursday's devotional introduced us to the Nasser family story outside of modern-day Bethlehem in the occupied West Bank. The land that the family lives on, this family, is a Palestinian Lutheran Christian family that has owned this land for generations. Today, that land and the organization that they've built around it functions as what is called the Tent of Nations. It's an educational and environmental farm that also practices the tactics of nonviolent resistance towards the Israeli government and the five illegal Israeli settlements that surround their land. They're essentially encompassed on all sides. The picture on the front of the bulletin today is of a rock that sits at the entrance to their land. I took that picture in 2013, just a few months before the Israeli government came in and bulldozed over 1,500 of their fruit trees. In addition to that, the family has been constantly under the threat of settlers trying to forcibly remove them from their land so that they can expand the settlement to that family land. But the phrase on the rock says in three different languages that it says, we refuse to be enemies. It says it in Arabic, in English, and in German. In Arabic, because that is their native language, and then in English and in German, because those are the two most common languages that are spoken in the settlements surrounding their land. I had the privilege of going there, and the author writes, and also did, and she says in the devotional, she says that when people came or come to harass the Nasser family, they offer them tea and a shady place to sit. Even in the midst of aggression, they offer hospitality. This type of hospitality has both the ability to disarm, but also the ability to create allies out of those who may be perceived as enemies. It is hospitality as resistance, and hospitality as a way of keeping humanity even in the most inhumane and inhospitable of times and places. Nicandeja says that hospitality is how people honor the humanity in one another on the underside of the empire. Amen. So when we welcome and show hospitality to those around us, and when people who live in inhospitable and occupied places show hospitality to those around them, especially those who the empire wishes that we do not see or welcome, we resist against the dehumanizing tendencies of empire and occupation. It is a way for us to keep people together who imperial forces want to try to force us to pull apart from. As Christ came into the world, he came into a world where his family and those around him, even in the midst of occupation, we're building community and practicing hospitality as a way of pushing back against the empire and the occupation within which they were. They were caring and supporting and looking out for each other because they knew that the occupation would not. Friends, this is something that we can all do. We may not be able to make big sweeping changes, and we often see that peace is a slower process than we would like it to be. But we can practice hospitality. We can seek to find the humanity in the other, and we can refuse to be enemies. So may we all join in on that practice, that faith. Perhaps there we will find Christ coming into the world again and again. In the name of the God who creates and redeems and sustains us. Amen.
keep standing. Let's join in the affirmation of faith with the Apostles' Creed, entitled Apostles' Creed Confronting Power. Let us affirm what we believe. I believe in God, who though almighty, chooses grace. Mirroring God, I reflect grace to all. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who emptied himself of title and position, demonstrating that true love serves others. In like manner, I serve others to demonstrate love. Jesus suffered injustice, was tortured, killed, and buried. On the third day, he rose again from the dead for our sake. I see injustice and choose to stand with the oppressed, the suffering, and the discarded. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who fills God's people, giving us joy and hope. May I be filled so that I can overflow for those who need joy and hope. I believe in the church, which unites with other followers in Christ, demonstrating grace, service, suffering, and presence. Amen. Please be seated.
Friends, we come now to our time of joys and concerns. What joys and concerns do we share this morning? Chris, do we have any from Zoom?
Jim asks, do you please pray for peace and cessation of war in the Middle East and the Ukraine?
Amen. God, in your mercy, our prayer. Colin? We got several around, so we'll start back here and then we'll make our way around and come back to you guys.
Thank you. I want to say thank you to the Lord because my family was saved last Wednesday. Last Wednesday, one of the worst gun battles took place right before our house on Cherwin Avenue. Somebody was shot dead. This is the first time that we ever have seen. Or we've been hearing this on the news, but this was the first time. I didn't have, when the gun battle was going on before the house, because of my back, I couldn't crawl in my room. But we stayed there. My vehicle was riddled with bullets. So I want to say thank you to the Lord for saving our lives.
God, in your mercy, our prayer, and for all of those who were involved and affected by the actual shooting that were outside as well. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Good morning, everybody. I would like to say that my mom is now 100% cancer-free. They were able to remove it all from her legs. Praise God for that. And I just ask that you keep her in your prayers for a very long recovering process.
Amen. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Colin, we got more up front on this side, too. Selective vision, yeah. Yes, Patty.
Good morning. I have a bunch of joys and praise. One, for all the volunteers in this church, for the fellowship hour, for the luncheon, which was miraculously pulled together, for the ministry of the food cupboard, which is magnificent and requires so much work, for the decorating of the church, for all the people who contributed poinsettias, and I could go on. Thank you so much. The music just brings joy and hope during this season. And I also thank you all for prayers for my mom who is doing better. Merry Christmas.
God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For our friends and neighbors, Roy Robson and Bob Beach.
God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For everybody traveling, hopefully I-95 will not be scary for all the people who are traveling in the coming week. And also, of course, for everyone who is celebrating with an empty seat at the table.
God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Good morning. Prayers for my older sister, who's going to have thoracic surgery on Thursday to see if she has cancer, and prayers for my younger sister, who's waiting for the results of her biopsy.
God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Any others? Okay, we do have one more. The kids have been working on something for the last several weeks, and I'll let Direxa explain.
Yeah, all through Advent, at the beginning of children's worship, the kids have been writing down their prayers on a piece of paper, and we have made a prayer chain over the course of Advent. They've shared some of their prayers with each other, and others they keep in their hearts, but these children pray for amazing things. Peace in the world, the end of wars, the end of hunger, the end of poverty. So everyone's doing a great job with these kids. So we're going to add this, our prayer chain, to the Christmas tree this morning. Okay. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Friends, let us go to God in prayer this morning. Savior God, the season of Advent has led us to prepare our lives and our hearts for the birth of your Son. But we question the readiness of ourselves and our world. We know well what the poet Madeleine L'Engle writes when she says, "This is no time for a child to be born, with the earth betrayed by war and hate." Yet you, O God, risk being born in a world such as this. You risk taking on flesh that is fragile, vulnerable, and new. O wonder of wonders and joy of joys. Everlasting God, your promised presence is a stark reminder of hope. As we find our way into pews and pulpit, we come to give you honor and praise. We come grateful for all the good gifts with which we have been blessed. We come to pray for those who are especially in need of hope. And so we pray for an end to warring madness. For the people of Israel and Gaza, for the suffering in Ukraine, for the humanitarian crisis in Congo, for the end to terrorism across the globe. We pray for innocents trapped under falling bombs,
We pray for peaceful diplomatic solutions to age-old conflicts. May your kingdom come, Savior of the nations, and your will be done. Gracious God, bind us together in faith and service. Enlighten us to the needs and the needy in our communities. Organize us for action to solve systemic problems. Help us to be hospitable and to make room in our communities for weary travelers, for people, for all of the Mary and Josephs in need of a safe place to stay. You've given us abundant resources, and so help us to share what we have, extend the table of fellowship, and make room for those who long to belong. God of compassion, bless us and those we love. Heal those suffering from the illness of winter. Strengthen those undergoing treatments like chemotherapy and radiation. Comfort those who've recently lost loved ones, those mourning empty seats at holiday tables. Renew those needing respite. Grant them the blessing of a holiday Sabbath. As you reach out to us through Jesus Christ, help us to reach out to those who suffer and struggle. Mighty God, whose word we trust and whose spirit enables us to pray, accept our requests and further those with which will bring about your purpose for our world. Finally, O God, hear us as we pray the prayer together that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our invitation to the offering. God became incarnate in a world burdened under the weight of oppressive taxation. Into that world, Christ comes as good news to the poor. May our gifts continue that good news as we follow the path of Christ. Thank you. all of us in unison dedicate this offering. God, who brings good news to all the nations of the earth, may these gifts be given in the confidence of that gospel truth. May we, in hope, look towards more peaceful days, and may we help bring them to fruition. Amen. Our next song, closing hymn, is hymn on page, hymn
Friends, as you go out now into the world, have courage, hold on to what is good, render unto no one evil for evil, strengthen the weak, support the faint-hearted, rejoicing always in the power of the Holy Spirit. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and those whom you love, both today and forevermore. Let us all say together, Amen.
Anything, take it at this time. You don't need your as much as.